So when there are luminaries along which your name and entire portrait is there, which clearly indicates that, I mean, person of your repute doesn't require an introduction. Still, we have a large gathering here, so I'll request Dr. TVV to take the stage from here and take it forward from here. Over to Dr. Venkatesh, and thank you so much, Professor Sujata, to have accepted our invitation. Over to TVV.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, Dr. Nakul Parasar, our Director Vigyan Prasar. Initially, what I would like to do is take 2 minutes to explain what this program is about, because there are a lot of people who have joined new, and then there are a lot of people who are joined our Vigyan Prasar Facebook Live. So to all the participants, I mean, you can also inform your friends that the Facebook Live has begun, so they can also join there. This year is the 100th anniversary of Ramanujam's death. So what we thought was that we should have a major all India level program from April 26th to December 22nd. That was our initial idea. We actually wanted to start this with a 3-day event in Kumbakonam, inviting a lot of people around the world and also in India. But unfortunately, due to the pandemic, I mean, this whole program had to be shelved because of this current situation. But we thought, despite this, we should do something. So what we decided was that every month, we will have at least 3 to 4 lectures on Ramanujam in different Indian languages, addressing different audience group. So there are people like Sastri, who is here, and Dr. Ramanujam. They have given talk in Tamil, Kannada, and then we have also had a talk in Telugu and Malayalam. Soon we'll be having in other Indian languages. In addition, we are also having a lecture called as Ramanujam Scholars. I mean, basically, people who are accomplished mathematician to give a talk on Ramanujam and his legacy to inspire young people in this country. That's a background for this program. So we have formed a national level committee where Dr. Ramanujam is one of the key coordinators for that committee. And there are also other members who have joined this program today. So I would request Dr. Ramanujam to introduce Dr. Sujata Ramadurai and start off the program.
Thanks, TV. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sujata Ramadurai. Sujata did a PhD at Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and is in University of British Columbia in Vancouver now. And she is Professor of Mathematics and Canada Research Chair. She's very well known for her work in Iwasawa theory, algebraic number theorist, and she got the ICTP Ramanujan Prize in 2006, the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in 2004, and she's also recently the recipient of the 2020 Krieger Nelson Prize for her exceptional contributions to mathematics research. It's a pleasure to have a mathematician of her caliber here in the Ramanujan lecture series. And she was also a member of the National Knowledge Commission and a member of the Prime Minister's Scientific Advisory Council and the National Innovation Council. And another important thing is she has started this Gyanom project, which is bringing very important insights and fun for mathematics learners at school. So, yeah, it's a great pleasure to have Sujata Ramadurai talk to us on Ramanujan, on Ramanujan's legacy. Over to Sujata.
Yeah. Thank you all for your kind words. Good morning from Canada and good night, almost good evening to all of you. Thanks for staying up. It's always a pleasure to talk about Ramanujan and not just his contributions, but how inspirational a figure he has been and his enduring legacy in mathematics. So you must have all heard the talk by Ken Nono. And in fact, it's almost coincidental. In a couple of days, we are having the screening of the movie, The Man Who Knew Infinity, here in University of British Columbia, along with a panel discussion. And this is more to focus on diversity in mathematics and diversity from a variety of points in the way one approaches mathematics, in the way one contributes to mathematics, and also cultural diversity. And so it's almost coincidental that there's so much happening about Ramanujan internationally, and I'm very pleased that this is made possible. I must first apologize for not being a very fancy presenter. I just have some very basic handwritten notes, and it's kind of difficult to do justice to Ramanujan's, to the breadth and scope of Ramanujan's work. And all I can hope to do is to convey to the audience how enduring his legacy is and how his work has found inroads into different areas of mathematics. Any interested student or anybody who is even nominally interested in understanding a little more of any of the topics that I'm going to talk about just has to do Google. You know, you just Google Ramanujan and that subject word, and then you will see the number of papers that have been written, the number of popular articles that have been written, the number of, you know, today even YouTube lectures that are there on Ramanujan's inspirational methods to attack problems and so on. So it almost, you can spend a whole year or more just watching a different video every day or reading something different about Ramanujan every day. So this talk is meant more to give you a very sweeping and swift glimpse of his work. I will intersperse it occasionally with more connections to other areas of mathematics, mention it briefly, and also intersperse it occasionally with personal comments. So let's get started. So I'm going to start with a few topics where Ramanujan's contributions has been lasting, and you know, people still refer to it after decay, I mean, after almost a century. So he has left, as we all know, an indelible mark on mathematics. And I always like to say that even though his life story is, the trajectory is tragic, it continues to inspire. So that inspirational aspect of Ramanujan's life, of course, in India, it takes different forms. Every student, every high school student or aspiring college student thinks he has proved a theorem, a celebrated problem which has been open for hundreds of years, and will write to many mathematicians saying, you know, I have a solution. And then when you try to tell them, no, no, this is a deep problem, it took years for people to understand how deep is it is. And, you know, if you prove it, you'll maybe get $1 million or a big prize and so on. Then their immediate response will be, oh, but Ramanujan was also like that. Nobody thought that he could do something, you know. So in that sense, he is an inspirational figure. And it's very touching that people get inspired by these humbler aspects of Ramanujan's life. And another thing I like to say about Ramanujan is largely that the West remembers the tragic course that his life took. You know, he was a meteor. He did all these amazing work and then burnt himself out and died at a very young, burnt himself out in the sense of physically, in the sense that his life ended at a very short, after a very short span. But I tell him that in India, people, of course, we feel very sad about his life taken away so quickly. But what we remember in India is the passion that he had for mathematics. And, you know, nobody, for instance, in my own life, when I wanted to do mathematics almost 40 years back, that was the time that everybody was moving towards computer science and medicine, the professional courses. And when I told my family that I wanted to do mathematics and didn't want to get into engineering, my family immediately understood. And they said, oh, you know, there was this great, of course, my late brother and I, we had grown up listening to stories about Ramanujan. And so they said, yeah, there was this great person, Ramanujan, who was so passionate about mathematics. They could have easily said, you know, what use is mathematics? Look, there was this great guy, he did mathematics, but brought him nothing. It only brought him an early death. But they never chose to remember that. They chose to remember the passion that he had. And I remember my grandmother telling us that even after he came back from England, when he was very ill, till his last breath, all he could think of was mathematics. So I find that very, very striking that as a culture, we chose to remember the passion that he had rather than the tragedy of his life. And as I touched upon briefly, you know, if you really want to do a serious job talking about Ramanujan's contributions to mathematics, it's just too vast, and I'm not even remotely qualified to speak about some aspects of his work because it spans such a diverse and vast area, which has acquired a life of its own. It has developed connections and made inroads into other areas. But since this talk is for a general audience, and again, I want to sort of get people to continue to be inspired and to see the beauty in Ramanujan's work. So I'm going to just present a sketch of his contributions in different areas. And I want to stress that many of these are deep areas in mathematics where there's continued research going on, and I'm not really working in those areas, and I only have a superficial aerial view of those, and which is what I'll try to present. So let's start with partition functions. That's because this is probably the simplest that one can explain even to a high school student or even to a primary school student. Suppose we take a positive number, let's call it n, then a partition is the way in which you can break n up. For instance, if n is 3, you can write it as 2 plus 1. You can also write it as 1 plus 1 plus 1. And we count the number of ways in which you can break this up. We are not going to count 2 plus 1 as being different from 1 plus 2. So therefore, you call this the ordered, unordered sequences. That is, you don't care whether it's 2 and 1 or 1 and 2. So let P of n denote the number of unordered sequences of positive integers which add up to n. And then here, for instance, this is the partition of 7. You have it in...
Sujata, you should share screen.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, oh, I'll have to technologically, it's just a bit challenging. So let me share screen. Okay. Enter full screen. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So for instance, if we have n equals 7, so you can break 7 into all these different ways. And this leads to what's called the partition function, P of n. Yeah, this is not going to be... So for instance, if we take 7, then I wrote down the number of ways. This is a good exercise for people to work out. So you can see that the partition of 7 is 15. So this defines a partition function. Take any number and write down the different number of ways in which you can break it up. And like I said, you don't count 1 plus 6 as being different from 6 plus 1 as a partition of 7. So here are some examples. P of 1 is 1, P of 2 is 2. P of 5 is 7, but very soon it quickly, there's no pattern. You don't see a pattern. First, when you look at the first four, you see, oh, okay, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, but then quickly 3 plus 5 is 8, but P of 5 is only 7. And then you see that the pattern just goes completely all right. And then P of 7 is already has 6 digits, and P of 70 runs into millions. So there's no pattern that can be viewed. So it's amazing that Ramanujan discovered patterns in the partition function. And he proved a lot of deep results on the partition function. Not just that, he also had a formula which is now today called the Hardy-Ramanujan asymptotic partition formula. This formula tells us how the partition function grows as n grows.
Sorry to interrupt. Can you please zoom in? It's too small.
Oh, sorry.
The screen is not coming. I think you have
better
screen. It's not full screen, so it's not able. Now only part of it is visible. Now it's fine.
Is this better? Okay. Please keep giving me inputs like this because I can't see the what's happening on the other side. From here, for me, it's full screen.
Okay. Oh, I see. Okay. Fine. Yeah. So sorry.
This is the in 1918. He proved this formula along with, it's today called the Hardy-Ramanujan asymptotic partition formula. And it says that as n grows to infinity, then this function asymptotically looks like 1 upon 4n square root of 3 and e to the power 5 and the square root times square root of 2n upon 3. Now, this has this function which Ramanujan, you know, I mean, it's still amazing. And Ken Ono always likes to say that if there is one person's mind he would like to get into, that is Ramanujan. So it's amazing the kind of patterns that he saw when he tried to understand the values of the partition function. And the, how did he do those computations? And this function has lots of applications today in many areas, including in probability. And it's an area of mathematical research even today. And it's inspired the study of similar functions in other areas as well. And this is about the partition function. Now, the next that I want to talk about is the continued fractions. So again, maybe I know that Ken is very fond of talking about how Ramanujan's genius made this simple leap of thinking about continued fractions. So the most famous continued fraction is perhaps this one. So a continued fraction, let me introduce the notation. So you just, so this is the notation on the right. So you take a fraction like this. So take an integer or take a number b naught plus a fraction a1. But now the denominator is again something of the form of the previous term. So it becomes b1 plus.
Sujata, we are not seeing the continued fraction.
Oh. Do you see it now?
No, we are still seeing the partition.
Oh, okay. Why is this?
The number of unordered. Yeah.
You share.
Yeah. Now we. No, we got it, but it went back. Can you?
Very strange.
Yeah.
Can you see it now?
This is fine.
Okay. Yeah. So a continued fraction, so you start with a number and then add to it a fraction where the numerator is a number, but the denominator is again a continued fraction, meaning it starts with an integer plus a fraction and this goes on endlessly. So the simplest one is where you take all of the numbers to be one. So it looks like one plus one upon one plus one upon one plus one upon, and it goes on ad infinitum. And then this is this very famous number, 1 plus square root of 5 upon 2. And this, Ramanujan was fascinated by continued fractions. And he looked at this simple continued fraction, which people knew about, and said, why, what is special about 1? What happens if I replace it with any other number? And then that led to what are called Rogers-Ramanujan functions. So let me introduce this notation. A semicolon Q bracket and then subscript N. So this is an infinite product of 1 minus A times Q to the K, where the product ranges from K equals 0 to N minus 1. That is the significance of the N here. And then you take the limit of all these. So this looks totally weird, right? I mean, you don't know what are these, what is this infinite product that you're taking, and then you're taking the limit of that. So let me stress here that Q has to have absolute value less than 1. Once it does that, then you can actually talk about the limit. Now, Ramanujan, you know, he displayed complete mastery over continued fractions. And this was something that was so striking to Hardy. You must remember that at that time, people were still trying to come to grips with what it meant for an infinite series to have a meaning, for an infinite product to have a meaning, and so on. And Ramanujan had completely mastered it in his own way without, you know, ever, I think, having to bother with what is convergence to give a precise meaning, but he just had an intuitive grasp of that. And he used continued fractions to give some incredible approximations to irrational numbers. We all know that irrational numbers on the real line, you know, they have decimal approximations. And at that time, one of the famous approximations that he gave was for the value of pi. And he used continued fractions to approximate pi to the best known decimal place at that time. No calculators, nothing, just sheer mastery over continued fractions along with pen and paper, which was of limited supply. Now, Rogers Ramanujan continued fraction, there's a special continued fraction where you take a Q with absolute value less than 1, and then you look at R of Q, which is this continued fraction. So you see he's done this incredible shift from just taking 1 and replaced it with Q, where the absolute value of Q is less than 1. And this continued fraction has inspired so many formulas. And today, if you just Google Roger Ramanujan identities, you will see, again, Google will give you back hundreds of pages. And is this visible now, Jan?
Yes, it is. It's fine.
Okay. So, and this special continued fraction led to a whole separate branch of mathematics called hypergeometric series. And in fact, before Ramanujan discovered it, it had been independently discovered by Rogers in 1894. And independently later, of course, Ramanujan, half of his discoveries, he had no idea of what had been done before. It was just stream of mathematical consciousness that he had. So here is the special, today it goes under the name of hypergeometric series. So you take this infinite sum, n equals 0 to infinity, and in this short notation that I introduced in the previous slide, it has this simpler notation, q to the power n squared upon q semicolon q subscript n. And then there are various identities, but you see this one, this infinite sum, turns out to have this incredibly beautiful formula. 1 plus q squared plus q cubed plus 2q to the power 4 and so on. And then there's another hypergeometric series called h of q, so which has a similar infinite series expansion. I'll not go into the details. And that again has this very beautiful infinite summation, 1 plus q squared, q plus q cubed and so on. Now remember that q has to have absolute value less than 1. And here is again the most beautiful identity. Remember, I introduced three functions. One was this Rogers Ramanujan R of Q, and then this hypergeometric series G of Q, H of Q. All of these are infinite sums. And then there is this beautiful formula. R of Q is a ratio of H of Q and G of Q along with these fractions, fractional powers of Q. How did he ever see this? And in particular, if we take, we all know that e to the power pi, e to the power I theta, these are special numbers whose absolute value is less than 1. So if you put back e to the power minus 2 pi, then you get back this sum which involves the golden ratio. So you have square root of 5 plus square root of 5 upon 2 minus this golden ratio, which remember was what we started with. When you took q equals 1, you had a formula which involved the golden ratio. So what Ramanujan did was, in one sweeping stroke, he gave a complete generalization of continued fraction, which people had worked with the special case of Q equals 1. He just generalized it completely. Okay, so now these go on today. These can you see this? The slides are okay. Is it full screen?
It's fine. Absolutely. Yeah.
So today, this whole series of hypergeometric series, you know, there's a whole vast body of mathematical research around it. It has connections to, again, various other forms, not just of mathematics, but in other areas as well. These go under the broad name of Rogers Ramanujan identities. And just this alone has inspired thousands of papers. People continue to work on it. And not just these identities, but Ramanujan had also in his time discovered congruence properties between these. In the sense, take two such identities, what common factors do they have? So congruence is modulo various primes. So which are the prime numbers which divide these for special values and so on? So this subject alone, Rogers Ramanujan identities, has inspired tens of thousands of papers. And it was these which, you know, led people like Bruce Berndt, to actually come to India in search of his lost notebooks and do the work around compiling all the work which people knew that must be scattered around in India and in Cambridge, and to try to compile them and for mathematicians to continue to work on them. Now this, and there is a continuation. We began with partitions and then we went to Rogers Ramanujan identities. And on the face of it, you don't see any connection between those. But Ramanujan could see that the summations, in the summations, you had these special summons, q to the power n squared divided by this q semicolon q n. He saw the relation that they had to partitions. So for him, it must have appeared as a seamless continuation of work that he was doing. Whereas for us today, we still don't understand how his mind jumped from partitions to hypergeometric series. So this together have inspired a whole body of mathematical research. And as I said, continues to surprise. It has connections with other areas, to mention a few: affine Lie algebras, vertex operator algebras. In turn, all of these have connections to mathematical physics and so on. So now let me come to perhaps, at least from a pure mathematician's point of view, some of the deepest insights which Ramanujan had. This goes under the broad heading of Ramanujan conjectures. So let's take the upper half plane. So think of the complex plane. Then you have the x-axis, and everything that lies above the x-axis, that is the imaginary part of the complex number, has to be positive. That's called the upper half plane. So let's denote any that by a complex variable z. So z, let z be in the upper half plane. And then you, this q, which has absolute value less than 1, should be, let's say, write it as e to the power 2 pi I z. Now, Ramanujan studied this famous tau function. We'll come to that later. But let's consider this abstract definition, delta of z, which is just this infinite product, q times product n equals 1 to infinity, 1 minus q to the n, 24. Again, this looks like an infinite product. You just don't understand what this is. But you can expand the right-hand side as a power series, right? 1 minus q squared and then 1 minus q squared whole squared. So keep doing that. So 1 minus q squared to the power, 1 minus q to the power n, 24. And you have to do this for all n, from n equals 1 to infinite. So you just get some humongous power series. Now, what Ramanujan did was looked at this power series and then said, okay, I'm going to write this as a power series delta in terms of q. And as a power series, it looks like n equals 1 to the power infinity, some coefficients tau of n, q to the power n. Now this tau of n, he also wrote down these values of these coefficients tau of n for n up to 30. So here are some examples: tau of 1 equals 1, tau of 2 equals negative 24, tau of 30 is this minus 29211840. Now this is called Ramanujan's tau function. And he saw patterns in these values of tau of n. And he conjectured, for instance, this is what is called the Ramanujan conjecture. So let me come to the next slide. Yeah, okay, is it visible, Jack?
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay, so these coefficients, this tau of coefficients, he saw these patterns. So it's multiplicative, it's a multiplicative function in the sense, if you take tau of mn, then this is actually tau of m times tau of n, whenever m and n don't have any common prime factors. And then if p is a prime and you take any power of a prime number, he had formulas on the behavior of tau on powers of primes. So tau of p to the power a plus 1 is equal to tau of p times tau of p to the a minus p to the 11 times tau of p to the power a minus 1. Now these formulas, when people in the West saw them, absolutely stunned them. They couldn't figure out how on earth he could view these, and later, of course, you can also ask for what are the prime numbers that divide the various coefficients? So if you take tau of k for some integer k, you can ask what are the prime divisors of tau of k. And not just that, he also estimated how big these should be. So for instance, if p is a prime, then the absolute value of tau of p should be less than or equal to 2 times the square root of p to the power 11 for any prime number p. Now, this is a very famous formula for people working in pure mathematics, because this inspired a whole variety of mathematical research, especially conjectures, and all of these go under the heading of, under the banner of Ramanujan conjectures. So model proved 1 and 2 in general, and this was proved in 1917. This third part, this inequality, was proved by Deline in 1974, for which he got the Fields Medal. And just a couple of years, just last year, to commemorate 100 years of Ramanujan, there was this special symposium organized by the Royal Society in Cambridge. And there were various people who were invited to come and give talks. And Peter Sarnak, one of the speakers and a very distinguished mathematician, he said, if there is one person who has inspired the work of the maximum number of Fields medalists and Abel Prize winners, it is Ramanujan. At least half a dozen, if not more, of these big prize winners, their work is directly related or inspired by Ramanujan's conjectures or Ramanujan's work. So today, of course, we view this Ramanujan's tau function under a totally different lens. We view it through this lens of what's called modular forms. So let me speak briefly about modular forms. So let's introduce SL2Z. These are 2x2 matrices with integer entries and determinant is equal to 1. So for example, let's take this, any element in SL2Z is a 2x2 matrix. So it looks like a matrix A, B, C, D, such that the determinant is AD minus BC, that has to be 1, and A, B, C, D are all integers. So here are some examples. Take negative 1, 0, 1, negative 1 across the diagonal, and then 1 and 0 across the anti-diagonal. That's an element in SL2Z. And 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, negative 1, 1, 0. These are all elements in SL2Z. Now, SL2Z by itself is a much studied object. But what's interesting is that SL2 acts on the upper half plane. If you take a point on the upper half plane and then think of it as a complex number, right? So you can write it as a vector and then operate on it by SL2Z, you again land on the upper half plane. So SL2Z acts as a function on the upper half plane. And we have this technical definition, a modular form of weight k, where k is an integer, positive integer, at least 1. With respect to SL2Z, this is a holomorphic function on the upper half plane. So it's actually a function f from h to the complex numbers, such that it has certain properties. It transforms with respect to SL2Z in a particular way. So let me explain that. Yeah. So this modular function on the upper half plane has to satisfy this property. F of AZ plus B upon CZ plus B transforms into CZ plus D times to the power K times F of Z, where K is this weight that I introduced. And then it has to be holomorphic as Z tends to the point infinity in the upper half plane. And now delta, this function that we introduced earlier, which was Ramanujan's tau function, this power series in tau times q to the power n, this is actually a modular form of weight 1. And Ramanujan knew it, even though he knew nothing about modular forms, this language and this description came much later, but he knew that it had all these properties. So any modular form has a q series expansion like this. These coefficients are called the Fourier coefficients, and Ramanujan in his head knew this connection. And to any modular form, you associate an L function, which is an infinite sum like this. It's a n upon n to the s. So you write f as summation a n q to the power n, then you just take a n divided by n to the power s. So think of s as a complex variable. So this is an L function. So you can study it as a function of a complex variable. And there are lots of open conjectures about the properties of this L function and so on. But the amazing thing again is that Ramanujan knew that in the special case for his tau function and that modular form, the delta that we wrote, L delta of S, which is this infinite sum, is also the infinite product. So this is a common theme in mathematics today. How do you go from infinite sums to infinite products? What are the functions which have this property that it has, you can present it as an infinite sum of a variable and also as an infinite product in a variable. So this, of course, this is the first example that we know of a function like this is the Riemann zeta function, which is as a summation, as a sum, it is expressed as summation n equals 1 to infinity, 1 upon n to the power s. And as a product, it's the product over all primes of 1 minus 1 over p to the power s inverse. So you look at the similarities. So the zeta function is a special kind of L function. Today, one studies functions of this kind under the broad heading of what are called L functions. One of the most studied objects in current mathematical research, again, many of the people who have won Fields Medals or Abel Prizes have their work directly related to L functions. And people are still trying to understand that. And Ramanujan had an inkling of this. So you see, I think in his brain, he saw this whole connection starting from partition functions to hypergeometric series to modular forms. And this is just one small aspect of his of the mathematical landscape he had in his mind. Okay, so now coming back, this is the last slide I have. And I just want to say that Ramanujan's conjecture has led to a whole variety of techniques and ideas, not just in arithmetic, but in geometry and arithmetic and in number theory in the last century. I want to mention a few, for instance, Langlands program. Even if you don't know what it is the most actively researched subject for the last 70, 80 years. The Weil conjectures, which I mentioned earlier, which won Delhi in the Fields Medal, and which somehow one of the key inspirations or insights from that is that Ramanujan's inequality on tau of p. So that's related to the Weil conjectures. And then Sato-Tate conjecture, these are some of the conjectures, these are names, but people working in mathematics will immediately realize that these are deep areas of mathematics where people of great repute are working, and the depth that is required to prove real theorems in these areas are really vast and deep. And all of these have a direct connection and relation to the mathematics that Ramanujan somehow already, part of it had worked in his head. And Ramanujan's work finds applications in diverse areas. You might have heard some of it already from Ken. For instance, in computer science, in electrical engineering, signal processing problems, graph theory. There is this whole area of graph theory inspired by what are today called Ramanujan's graphs. And most surprising, theoretical physics, string theory, black holes, all of these today somehow seem to have connections with Ramanujan's tau functions, the values of tau and so on. So superstring theory, all of these, number theory has connections to these, and these, the areas of number theory that are connected to that have something to do with Ramanujan's work. So more than half a dozen top prizes, like I mentioned, the Fields Medal, Abel Prize, have been inspired by Ramanujan's work. And I'll close with this quotation of Hans Rademacher, who was a number theorist, German number theorist from 1892 to 1969. He once said of, I think he said this of Ramanujan's tau function. This is again an instance of Ramanujan's gift of divination. Not only that he foresaw or unveiled hitherto unknown facts, but most of his conjectures lead back to sources of great depth and abundant yield. And mathematicians to this day are diving into his mathematics and harvesting an abundance of ideas and beauty. So let me close with that. Thank you very much. We'll be happy to take a few questions.
Thanks immensely, Sujata. That was wonderful. Over to Venkateshwar and to coordinate the Q&A.
Thank you, Dr. Sujata, and thank you, Dr. Ramanujam. As our director said, that every day when we visit our office, particularly my place, I see your photograph. It's on the corridor. Okay. So there is one question that has come in the Facebook Live. So first, let me start with that so that by the time people can also post their question in the chat. The question that has come in the Facebook Live is, how is Ramanujan conjecture connected with Weil's conjecture? Weil.
Okay. So, you know, I need a blackboard to explain this. That's going to be difficult. But you see, what, so we spoke of, I mentioned this Riemann zeta function. Now later, then I mentioned this L function and said this L function is a generalization of the Riemann zeta function. Now you can define something like the Riemann zeta function, which is like a bridge between the Riemann zeta function and the L function. You can define it for, let's say, objects coming from equations over finite fields. So take a field with finitely many elements. That's a finite field. So take equations over this finite field, and then you want a bunch of equations, not just one equation, but let's say a bunch of equations. So then you want to look at the simultaneous solutions of this bunch of equations. Then this gives rise to what's called a variety over a finite field. So this is a geometric object. And then you can define the zeta function associated to this variety, which really comes from equations over finite fields. And you want to study the zeta function. So you want to understand the properties of these zeta function. And this zeta function, like I said, is a bridge between the Riemann zeta function and the L function. So you're interested in its zeros and what values it takes. And there are very precise formulas for the Riemann zeta function. And that's the connection to Weyl conjectures. Weyl actually solved this problem of the nature of the zeta function.
Yeah.
Deline, Weyl conjectured what it should look like and Deline proved it.
Okay. So there is one comment that has come here, which is can we take some aspect of Ramanujam's maths, perhaps something like a continued fraction or partition in school syllabus? Would that be interesting? I mean, that's...
Yes, I mean, for instance, that partition is something that's quite simple, right? You can ask students to just, for them to understand what a partition is. It's just a way of dividing your given number into different ways of adding it up. This can be introduced already in primary school. And, you know, for them to understand, this will also give them a way to understand that addition is commutative. 2 + 1 is the same as 1 + 2. So definitely the partition function, but of course it will be too much to expect the children to understand that this is an object of deeper properties, which is even today at the center of current mathematical research. Right? For instance, they can very quickly discover that maybe up to p^7 or p^8, they can work it out by hand, but very quickly they cannot write down all of the partitions for the numbers as the numbers grow larger.
Yeah. So there are two questions. So I'll put both of them so you can answer. One is in the Facebook again. It's asking that group with the order greater than 5, are they abelian or not? That's one question. Then the second is, what is the significance of 24 in the delta function on the upper half plane?
Okay, for this groups, of course, there are non-abelian groups of order greater than 5. So let's see, what was the other question? Yeah, 24, I don't know. I really don't know.
Is it like number 42 answer for everything?
No. I think the people in modular forms probably know why 24 comes. Maybe Ken can answer it better. But maybe, I don't know. I'll have to think about it. I don't know it at the top of my head. Yeah.
Okay. There is another question that it has come. What is the idea, Ramanujam's idea, which is actually used in ATM? I think that's one question that has come here. And next one is, can you suggest some book on Ramanujam conjecture which are understandable at the school level?
Actually, you know, this is something that at the school level, maybe Vigyan Prasar has it. Vigyan Prasar, I remember many years back, they had these three books on Ramanujan's mathematics, on basic number theory, some of which intersected with Ramanujan's mathematics, which was meant for school, high school and PU, up to PUC level students. I don't know if that's still available in print. Maybe it should be made available on the web today.
Yeah.
And what was the ATM? I don't know. Maybe it's Ramanujan's graphs. the partition function and Ramanujan's graph. These are two things I know that probably will have applications, but again, I really don't know.
Yeah. Actually, I mean, last a few days, this story about a prisoner who has done some mathematics from prison. I don't know whether you have read about it. He has worked on continued fraction. So that story actually talks about how continued fraction is used in ATM, and also talks about
continued fraction. Is it okay? That's interesting. Yeah, I didn't know this. See, again, these people. I think we should bring out small booklets or make small animation movies, which explains the mathematics and also its application. Because most of the, that's one thing that holds back mathematics, right? I mean, everybody, see, I'm sure many of the people don't understand a gene or don't understand the latest laws of physics and so on. But they somehow have this feeling that physics, biology, all of these are useful, but they don't understand why mathematics is useful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually the books that you are referring, right? Like for the students at primary level, high school level on Ramanujam and Ramanujam mathematics, that is actually brought out by AMPA. Association of Mathematics Teachers of India. Yeah. It's available. Actually, it's also available in the website. I mean, like if people search, I mean, they can even get a copy of it. Perhaps one should look at how one can make it available in a wider way. Actually, if you go to the website of Arvind Gupta, this material is available, which is there is, so this is one question. So let me just get a few other questions.
Oh yeah, Vijay Kumar, I noticed, has mentioned, there's a very nice book by Ramamurthy, which again, I don't know how widely it's available in India, but that's a very beautiful book on Ramanujan's mathematics. And again, Bruce Burnt and others have given, even if it's not published as books, you can find it on the web. Lots of very accessible write-ups about Ramanujan's mathematics.
So I think in terms of questions, that's what we have right now. Let me also just take a look at Facebook. There is also another question which says that, can you explain some application of Ramanujan's conjectures?
Okay, application of Ramanujan's conjectures, it's mostly in pure mathematics. So like I said, you have this broad study of L functions. You know, these L functions have the special property that you can write them as an infinite series and also as an infinite product. Mm. And of course, Ramanujan's delta modular form, the L function associated to that, is one such example. But you want to understand, just like for the classical Riemann zeta function, there is the famous Riemann hypothesis, which predicts where the zeros are lying. You know, the conjecture is that it lies only on the half line. So similarly, there are questions about the zeros of L functions. Where do they occur? And L values, what kind of values do the L functions take? Are they rational numbers? Are they transcendental numbers? When are they rational? When are they irrational? All of these questions, which somehow again mysteriously seem to come up in theoretical physics, which I think a mathematician who is studying L functions separately in her wildest dreams would not have thought that this comes up in the study of black holes. But for some reason they do. And that's the beauty about mathematics. You study it because it fascinates you, but then it keeps turning up at remote corners in the most unexpected of places.
Okay. So there is one question. Most fascinating is how he came up with these identities and conjectures. Is there any research or resources that shed light on how he came up with these?
So there are people who somehow, one caveat here. So people today know that not every formula that he wrote down is correct. There are a few which are wrong. And I think people understand what are the mistakes that he made to get these wrong formulas. But I think it's fair to say that people still don't understand how he got so many formulas right. And that's why Ken Nono likes to say that if there's anybody's mind he would like to time travel back into, it is Ramanujan's.
Yeah. There is two questions which are kind of similar, not similar in that sense, but again, Facebook. Before I take the chat, I'll take the Facebook first. One is Riemann's hypothesis and Ramanujam. Similarly, Fermat's last theorem and Ramanujam.
Okay. So that's the second one is my favorite. So I can talk about it for the next hour, which I won't do. But Riemann hypothesis and Ramanujan. So you see the Riemann hypothesis, that is something that predicts the behavior of the Riemann zeta function, which I wrote down. Zeta of s is summation 1 over n to the power s, n equals 1 to infinity, where n goes from 1 to infinity, and s you view it as a function of a complex variable. And like I said, the most important conjecture on the Riemann hypothesis is where do the zeros of the Riemann zeta function lie? What are the zeros where it lies? Now, the Riemann hypothesis also has relations to the distribution of prime numbers. We know that there are infinitely many prime numbers, but how are they distributed? You know, for instance, when you look at 1 to 100, you can see, you can count all the prime numbers. But as you go farther and farther, as the numbers become larger, then the primes become sparser. So what is the gap between two prime numbers? How do you measure it? So in all of this, the Riemann zeta function plays a role. Okay, so that's one area where the Riemann hypothesis comes in, and the Riemann zeta function plays a role. Now the other part, Fermat's last theorem. So we wrote this L function, right? We said take any modular form F, then F can be written as summation an q to the power n. And then you can define an L function, which is an imitation, which is copying the Riemann zeta function, namely L of fs is summation an over n to the power s. So in the numerator, you just take the Fourier coefficients coming from the modular form. Denominator is the same as that for the Riemann zeta function, n to the power s. Now, again, you have lots of conjectures about this L function. You just know it as a function on the complex plane, but is it analytic? What are its poles? Is it meromorphic? Is it analytic? Where are its zeros? Where are its poles? And so on. Now, elliptic curves. Now, Fermat's last theorem is something about elliptic curves. You are studying an equation of the form y squared equals f of x, where f of x is a cubic equation over q with coefficients in q. Now, to any object, you can again associate an L function. So to an elliptic curve, you can associate an L function called L of ES. Now, Fermat's last theorem, one step you needed was to say that the L function associated to any elliptic curve really is the L function associated to a modular form.
Okay,
so that's how the L functions come in there. Yeah.
Yeah, so there are two questions. Again, I'll put them together. One is, how is Mach theta function, Mach theta function have any connection with the plasma physics? That's one question. Then, can you say a few words about Gynome project?
Gynome, okay. So, yeah. Mach theta functions, again, I'm not an expert. It brings together so many different things. For instance, at least in mathematics, in group theory, you want to classify all groups, all the finite groups you want to classify. And people thought this was done. And then when in the course of classification, there were these huge, enormous, simple groups, which are called today monster, moonshine, various things. And those turn out in physics. And plasma physics, I don't know plasma physics. I don't know Mach theta function. So I really can't talk about that. I'm not an expert. But I know that Mach theta functions, and again, that is related to modular forms, what are called Mach modular forms, which almost behave like modular forms, pretend to be modular forms. And this is also related to moonshine, these huge groups that come up, which in turn is related to representation theory in mathematics, and which comes up as invariance in physics. So that's the broad picture I have. I don't know the details. Ken would be the right person. Again, but you can find lots of accessible articles written for the general public on moonshine and the monster and so on. So you can read that. Okay, so let me talk about the Gynome project. So this was something which was in my mind since I was a member of the National Knowledge Commission. You know, at that time we kept talking about India becoming a global superpower and all our students becoming global citizens, etc., etc. And then there was a disconnect because our students didn't even have access to quality education or quality resources. And today with the digital divide, which is so pronounced today in these COVID times, you know, I feel that whatever gains we had made in education, they have been set back because half the students don't have access to resources. And in India, in a diverse and complicated landscape like India, it's not just resources as in the classroom. You need digital resources, and you need digital resources in their vernacular languages, because we have this enormous cohort of first generation learners. So the parents send them to English medium school, but there's a total disconnect between what the child is learning in school. Because English becomes a barrier, but English is also aspirational. So we wanted to bridge that gap by putting out quality resources, accessible free of cost to all the children, aligned to the NCERT syllabus in mathematics. So Gyanom is a project which creates presentations based on the NCERT syllabus in English and in many other languages for free use among teachers. And we want the teachers to contribute to this. Because I am convinced that unless the teachers become participants and content creators, we are not going to become global citizens. Mm. You know, so how do we provide a platform for teachers to participate and display their creativity? That's the one. And I see that there's something about talking. Somebody's asked me to talk about the Ramanujan Math Park. I would invite all of you to please go visit it. This is almost our humble homage to Ramanujan, if you like. This is a mathematics park. It was executed by Shastri. It is in the campus of Agastya Foundation. It is in between Kolar and it's in Kolar, in between Bangalore and Chennai on the train line. So this is a huge open air math park. They have other science parks there. There are science centers in the Kuppam Agastya Foundation, Kuppam Science Center. But we conceived this as a open air park. It's interspersed with mathematical exhibits which are out in the open air and also inside closed rooms. We didn't want to museumize mathematics because people associate math and museums. We didn't want them to associate both of them with double boredom. So this is part of it is open air. Children can actually come and interact with mathematical exhibits and learn about how mathematics is interlinked to physics or chemistry or biology. So when they visit the whole park, then they can actually relate the mathematics, let's say in physics or in chemistry or in biology, and also independently mathematics in real life, which are in the open air exhibits. So please do visit it. Shastri was the executor of that. So I would really invite all teachers and students and parents. It's a wonderful, the whole campus is wonderful, and it's really a learning experience. And it's aimed especially for the students from the villages, because we found that they are the ones who still have an open mind and who are curious.
Yeah.
So that's why we located in a remote place. Yeah.
Yeah. So there is one more question which says that why don't we introduce Vedic mathematics in school? That's one question.
Okay. I'm not an expert in Vedic mathematics. My limited learning, going through the books or going through that or trying to understand it. For me, for instance, there are supposed to be all these quote unquote shortcuts, let's say, to multiplication. But just glancing at it, it seemed that the rules that you had to remember for these shortcuts were as complicated as actually learning the multiplication process. So I don't know, maybe there are some students and teachers who are better at understanding why these shortcuts are really shortcuts, but I'm not one of them.
One more interesting question that is saying that how to encourage teachers to take part in preparing the lesson plans to spread the joy of mathematics learning. I mean, the joy of mathematics learning, I think, is a important keyword there. Yeah.
Right. So again, I mean, so please do go to this website, gyanom.org. And there is one tab. So now we are working with IIIT Bangalore. So we want to really convert all of these into the different languages and complete the content creation up to class 10. And then also include other aspects of the joy of learning mathematics. We want it to become a teacher's platform. So this is still work in progress. But once it is up, there will be a button where teachers can click and say, I want to contribute. Or I want to be part of this. And then we'll get back to you. We want to hold periodic workshops where we bring the teachers and then listen to them. And then, you know, because the teachers are the one who interact in the classrooms. So get their inputs and get them to be part of this movement almost. So please keep looking at this website. Click on Making Maths Count. That's what this project is called on the Gyanom page. And it's still, the website is still under construction, but once it's constructed, there will be a button where people can click saying they want to volunteer or they want to contribute and so on, and then we'll get in touch with you.
That's a very nice point. I think that's a good point to also wind up this session today. I'm sure you've not even taken your morning breakfast or even coffee, perhaps. What does it mean?
Breakfast with me.
Yeah, it was a very, very nice and excellent lecture. So can I ask our director, Dr. Narukul Parasa, to say a few words before
thank you all. Thank you all very much for staying up so late.
Lastly, Sasriji will also give the vote of thanks. So we'll have some words from Narukul Parasaji.
Well, thank you so much, Professor Ramdharai. It was great to have heard you after a very long time. Something that I'd been aspiring for last 18 months, ever since I've joined this place, wanted to hear and talk to you. Nice opportunity, and thanks to Ramanujam Professor Ramanujam from IMSC. Thanks to Dr. Venkateshwaran and the entire team that has taken this Ramanujam Yatra to this level. So once again, from the entire Vigyan Prasar, all organizers here, I wish to thank you. But I wouldn't, snatch this opportunity of vote of thanks from a person whom you refer to. So Shastriji is here, and I'll request Shastriji to do the honors. Over to Shastriji.
Before that, I have one request. So I see that various people want my email, etc., etc. So if one of you can coordinate that, and I would also be interested in getting the feedback about this. So if you can, somebody can collect it, that would be very nice. Thank you.
Yeah. Sri, can you put your email ID in the chat box so that people can write to you, and then we can collect and carry on?
I'll do that.
So all friends who are in the session, if you want to write to her or ask any questions or put something, please write to this email ID. We will collate and then coordinate with her for the responses. So can we now call Sasriji, please?
Oh, yes, sir. Yep. Really glad, to see Sujata, in the heart and the healthy. And also, she is one mathematician, from India, who is having done, some work, really, on the ground by creating, Gyanom website, as well as, the math park, to be accessed, by all. And today's lecture, was really an eye-opener. And the kind of connections, she made, with Ramanujan mathematics to all the other fields, definitely will inspire, others also, to look, into deeper. In fact, the questions, people are asking, the references for the YouTube, etc. itself, shows the kind of a curiosity she has aroused, with the people. So thank you, Mrs. Sujata, for this kind of a wonderful lecture. In fact, the Ramanujan Yatra, will be, perhaps, it is more, now, open, to the people, of like you, to come and, interact. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Okay, good night.
Thank you all.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Sujata.
Yeah, bye.
Bye.